afternoon, everyone. I'm not so sure whether you've been intimidated by my learned friend Edmund over this last couple of minutes of talk. Right, he's the so-called bad guy, he's supposed to be the good guy. So what I will tell you today through a couple of cases is how we help MPS and the doctors of MPS manage medical legal scenarios. And I think in the course of what I will say, there will be some points which I will probably defer with Edmund, I will come to that. Now the first case scenario, in fact, maybe before I go to the case scenarios, these are real cases, right, which MPS has passed on to me to just share with you. Now you'll find that they are bereft of details in terms of facts, and they're very sketchy. The purpose is really for me to take you through how we normally look at these cases and the kind of advice and assistance that we give to the doctors. Now, so this is one situation of a 71-year-old lady presenting to A&E with pain and swallowing after eating fish. Okay, so immediately I think your mind will be fish bone somewhere in the body. Then referred to ENT, neck x-ray and chest x-ray, reported as clear. And this is the interesting part. Following day, you got this radiologist reporting speculated opacity, 2.5 by 2.7 cm in the right lower zone, the lung. So this is a bit of a red flag there, right? Patient had surgery to remove the fish bone that day. Then what happened? No, the ENT surgeon did not communicate this speculated opacity to the patient or the family members. 2 years later, patient presented with hemoptysis, right, coughing up blood, and also blood in the sputum. Lung cancer was then removed, followed by chemotherapy. Now you can obviously imagine the family members of the patient was very upset and say, hey, how come you did not tell us about this speculated opacity? Because later on, they took out a cane and this fact came to light. So what do we do in situations like this? Now just now, I think you have heard Edmund talk to you about duty of care, you know, breach and all. But let me just put things in perspective. Now, usually in medical legal claims, right, there will be a few things to look at. Now, first of all, it will be for the patient to prove, first of all, that there's duty of care. Now, usually that's assumed. Doctor-patient relationship is such that there will always be, you know, the law will always impose the duty of care. It can be under contract, it can be under common law, or we call law of torts. The contention is always, did the doctor fall below the standard of care? Alright, now, just because there's a misdiagnosis, or for the matter, just because there's a complication materializing does not by that fact alone mean that there's a falling below the standard of care. So what determines standard of care? Now, just now you may have heard Edmund mention about a case called Bodum, right? Now, Bodum is not just Bodum, but actually it's Bodum Bolito. Two names, Essentially, Bodum test goes for this proposition, that the standard of care is based on what the responsible body of medical opinion, right, of a particular specialty or skill says the standard to be. And that is not all. It has to be logically reached, right? And Bolito is the case that actually qualifies for them to that extent. So Walter Bolito is actually our test, which has been applied since Gunapati. Some of you may remember that case in the year 2000. Right? Gunapati was a court of appeal decision. After the case, there were a series of high court decisions, and it's all mentioned by Edmund on his slides, in Surinder Singh's case, Ong Ming Chuan's case, and then in Man Kei's case, Gordon Yao as well, right? So, a long line of authorities have now established that this Bolan Bolito test actually applies to three key aspects, right? Duty of care in terms of diagnosis, in terms of advice, and in terms of treatment. So that is still our law. Whether one day we will go the direction of Rogers with Vicker, Fufioma, and all that, only time can tell. Okay, so far no indication, so far it's still Bolan Bolito. So essentially, whenever we have cases like that, we will always get our own expert. First thing MPS do would be to authorize us to instruct an expert. Look at whether there is a breach of the duty of care in terms of lowering of standard. Right? So if there's issues of breach of standard of care and also causation issues, obviously, there will be a need to settle the matter. Alright, so for this particular instance, I think another thing you need to look at is the SMC Ethical Code and Guidelines. I don't know how many of you actually are familiar with this document, because recently, I had one young doctor coming to me, poor fellow faces a SMC complaint, so I asked him, do you know SMC Ethical Code and Guidelines? So he said a neat black cake. Alright, so I had to point out to him that it's such a document. Now, it's important because one of the high court cases actually says that sometimes looking at the standard of care right, the court will actually go and look at the ethical guideline and ask itself, could this be a standard of care? So 4.1.1.5 of the SMC Ethical Coding Guidelines actually says that the doctor not only must provide competent, compassionate, and appropriate care, one of the aspects is to ensure the results of the test are communicated to the patient and the most appropriate management is expeditiously provided. Right? So if you look at the ethical standard, right? I mean, it's very difficult for any expert to say that, well, if you know of a particular abnormality, and in this case, quite an obvious abnormality, you can just be quiet and not tell the family, right? In this case, had it been told to the family, communicated early to them, perhaps they could have gone for further investigations, done a certain referral, and perhaps they could have treated earlier. So obviously, you know, this is one of those, what I call, hard-to-defend cases, indefensible ones, and that's why the matter of hacking was settled for a modest sum. So how do you avoid situations like this? I think some of the speakers earlier mentioned about things to the extent of saying that sometimes you look at the helicopter view, try to cast a wider net and not just look at the immediate medical history, just the subjective inputs and you know, rest of the matter there. You have to go a bit further sometimes when objective reports show something perhaps sinister or even abnormal. Bring it to the attention of the family, discuss with them, let them participate in the decision as to what they want. Okay, so I think that would be the first case that I'll show and share with you. Now the second one involves a girl who injured her foot on a broken glass door. Right? She went to the A&E for the claim, right? And then there was, I think, an intention to have the matter referred to an orthopedic surgeon. Surgical toilet and suture. Now she was advised exploration, but she declined, right? And she decided to just go away because she didn't want exploration under 3A. Additional fact is that this girl actually had some grains before she presented at A&E. So I think if you're going to put her under 3A for exploration, it's going to be problematic as well. Anyway, she didn't want, she declined, she went away. Recorded in the notes, and very careful recording in the notes in terms of the risk involved if she doesn't go through the exploration, etc. Now, 3 weeks later, things always happen this way. 3 weeks later, and some anterior tendon laceration was confirmed on an ultrasound scan because I think she continued to feel unwell at the area. Then, again, this is usually what happens when patient, after they go from one medical institution to another and they see another doctor, and the other doctor tells them something, they will point finger and say, hey, hello, you didn't tell me earlier that I had this problem. So this also happened. Direct tendon repair then was performed a week later by another surgeon and somewhere else. Now interestingly, prognosis was unchanged, and it wouldn't have made a difference whether she had that, you know, repair done earlier or 4 weeks later. So what happened in this case? She was unhappy, right? She claimed that the hospital, the A&E, was negligent in missing the diagnosis of a tendon injury, and she wanted to mount a claim. Now obviously, the notes recorded very clearly, right, the advice that was given to her. So it's very difficult for her to actually mount a case when there's clear advice in the notes that it was she herself who did not want to go to the exploration, which would have got the injury earlier. In addition, there's also the prognosis. Right? There was no damage in a way. So if you go in terms of duty breach, causation, and damage, there is no causation, there's no damage. So as a result, the claim, of course, was well defended because of the notes. Now, I think it's very important to know that for notes taking, in terms of what SMC Ethical Code and Guidelines says, this one, no, I'll just read to you very quickly. In terms of medical records, some of you may not know. Medical records kept by doctors shall be clear, accurate, and legible, and shall be made at the time the consultation takes place, okay? Or not long afterwards, and this has to be contemporaneous. Now, more importantly, medical records shall be of sufficient detail so that other doctors reading them will be able to take over management of the case. Okay? All clinical details, investigation results, discussion of treatment options, informed consents, etc., should be documented. Okay, so this is what SMC Ethical Guidelines says. So it is not a question of length. Sometimes there are doctors asking me, how would I have time if I've got to treat, got to advise, I got to write down so many things, you know? It's not a question of length. It's sufficiency. And the rule of thumb is always to ask yourself, if you were the one taking over conduct of this patient, would you be able to understand what was written? Right? So if you apply this over the yardstick, I think it's very difficult to form you on that. And I think, again, some of the speakers just now mentioned the importance of the criticality of good notes in medical legal cases. I can confirm that. In fact, I think I read somewhere two learned authors actually wrote this. Good notes equals good defense. Poor notes equals poor defense. No notes equals no defense. Now, the third proposition I won't go so far. It doesn't mean that no notes equals no defense. I mean, that can be also peripheral evidence. But it will be a very difficult and challenging defense to mount. So be aware of documentation. Like I said, medical legal tribunal for complaint. It's one of those things that you must make sure that it's properly documented. I had one case before, this doctor who came to me. Before he came to me on the phone, he was telling me the beautiful management plan he had for this patient, which he was giving benzodiazepines. Right? So you know benzodiazepines is one of those tricky situations. So he was telling me on the phone, wow, you know, I did that for this patient. So a lot of things were told on the phone. So I said, okay, let's meet up, show me your notes. Okay, and I look at the notes. Three columns, beautiful three columns. First column, the date of consultation. Second column, how many tablets of Domitum. And the third column, you thought there would be some indications of treatment. The price. How to find, you know? So of course, one of those cases where we have to tell the doctor, don't be practical. Because if you're going to mount a defense before the tribunal, the Supreme Tribunal, you're going to lie your story. Because the notes don't bear what you say. All right? So bear that in mind. Now the next one, one I'd like to share because this is actually a case we handled. This one's a live case. Some of you may have some recollection of this case. Mother, in fact, I think it's just more than mother. Mother and I think the grandmother also was this baby trying to register themselves at a GP clinic. I think the baby was running a fever. And this was near closing time, I think 15 minutes before the clinic was about to close. Then the receptionist, you know, it's closing time, told the family, cannot take you anymore, please go back. Please go to the other clinic, two doors away. So there was this exchange, very heated exchange. Now, at some point, the doctor emerged also from the consultation room. And unfortunately, there was a patient in the waiting room that filmed the incident using her mobile phone. Nowadays, mobile phone is so wonderful. People will just go around, you know, recording anything and everything you can see. Okay, so it was recorded. That's not all. You know, this wonderful patient thinks that she wants to win some award in journalism. Boom. Storm. All right? And of course, it was picking up of this news by the local press. You know. So the poor doctor who called us was a very young doctor, and he was in locum at this clinic. So, of course, when we went to see him, you know, the first thing he told us is, whatever is on the storm, this video clip, it's not the whole story. So he started telling us the whole story. So apparently, it wasn't so simple as him just pointing at the finger, because what you can see on storm is only this. So it's as though he's the one, you know, who initiated it after 5 minutes left. Okay. So apparently, what happened was, the family first went there, right, had this altercation with the receptionist, ran away, and then returned again, and made a lot of noise that the poor doctor was seeing another patient could not carry on. Now, obviously, he got a bit annoyed. So he tried to come out and tell the family, look, you know, there's another clinic, who also can go there. And they didn't buy him, whatever he said. They just continued, I think, you know, harassing him. Until the poor doctor, I think it was a long day for him at night. You know. So I think he just broke down, and that was the moment of truth that was picked up and put on spawn. And so the poor person, you know, of course he was very apologetic when we saw him. He said, you know, I would want to apologize. This is the kind of conduct that cannot be, you know, correct. So we confirm that because if you again look at SMC ethical code and guidelines, attitude towards patients. Patients should be treated with courtesy, consideration, compassion, and respect. Okay? It doesn't stop there, mind you. Okay? It reads on, and this is the interesting part. Now, on the other hand, the doctor is not obliged to allow himself to be subject to abuse of any kind by patients or relatives. Where such abuse occurs, provided there is no need for self-defense against physical harm, doctors shall not retaliate, but end the engagement with the patient as quickly as possible, in a professional manner. So it is a bit difficult, right, when you have only him pointing finger, not the other way around. So what do we do? Now, upon being contacted, we rushed down because the family was so aggressive. You know, they actually told the doctor, we're going to point the press at a press conference with you at the clinic. So we were activated, so we had to go to the clinic, look for the poor doctor, bring him to one corner, and took the instructions from him. So he said, can you be with us there, you know, as my lawyer? So of course, we assess the situation. Sometimes it's not feasible for us to be present because you actually can rile up the family wrongly. You'll be thinking, you must have done something wrong, right? Go and get a lawyer. So, of course, we told him, let's stay by the side, just outside the vicinity, but contactable. If you need any distress, let's come over, we'll be there. Right? So we were there. Also, we advised him to be apologetic, okay, and make reasonable apology. We also even offered to get him a hamper, you know, like a goodwill sort of apology thing. And we decided to add bird's nest inside, yeah, because of all the raving and ranting, maybe we need some atonement for the lunch. So everything was done in good taste, okay? But then the family rejected the hamper. They wanted a letter of apology. What is significant about this letter of apology is the family wanted their own account of events, which is untrue. Right? They wanted false information to be put in the letter of apology. Now, God only knows why you want that in. We suspect they have certain agenda, right? You could use it to do an SMC complaint, etc. So we advise the doctor, look, you apologize only for your conduct, but you don't agree to putting in false facts, right? You cannot go that sort of mouth. So of course the doctor agreed with us, and there was a lot of toing and froing, you know, because the family, I don't know why, they keep changing their mind in terms of what they want, okay? So at the same time, we have to monitor storm, because there's all this anxiety and interest, media interest. Then the doctor was asking us, should we also come into, you know, to put some holes in the storm to put our side of the story. Now we are in a situation where we're in a losing battle for you. 28,000 views on storm, mostly about referring you to SMC, and then there you are, you want to go up and tell your side of the story. So we said, let's hold it. Okay, let's perhaps monitor the situation. Sometimes, you know, social media is fluid. Right, things may be fluid and after a while they've forgotten. True enough. 3 days later, it tapered off, so there wasn't any more sort of interest on the media. At the same time, we had to help the doctor prepare in case if there has an SMC complaint. Right? So we had to help him go through his explanation, etc., just in case of that. Also to get corroborated evidence from the receptionist, etc. So we prepared, and then after a while, the matter ran away. Okay, so the whole thing just got de-escalated. He didn't face an SMC complaint. Right? So this is one example of how we sometimes will have to help the doctors. But I think the important thing is when sometimes things like that happen, right, don't bend over backwards to accommodate the patient, especially when you have the letter of apology situation. Don't go and accommodate them, but in the process say something false which will escalate. Okay? I know I've got 1 minute left. Okay, this last 2 slides, one is on confidentiality, one is on consent. Confidentiality scenario is this: 24-year-old male presented to A&E with history of fight with friend because of hand. On examination, laceration is also aspect of the forearm, fractured second like a whole bone, discharged home within 3 days. Then the police contacted the A&E next day, wanting information regarding a man that fit the patient's description in connection to breaking the local news agent. Okay, now you suspected it's this guy. Do you on your own go and tell the police, hey, this is probably the How many of you in the room actually think you should do that? Raise your hand. Okay, so none of you. Now remember, confidentiality, although it's not absolute, there are certain exceptions. But those exceptions also, you need to be very careful and know what they are. Now, of course, the first exception to confidentiality is if the patient himself consents to disclosure, without any elaboration required. Second one is where there is legislation requiring disclosure. One example, your Infectious Diseases Act, or your Regulation 19 of the, that's the drug one, I can't remember what it's called, Misuse of Drugs Regulations, okay, where if you actually find a patient that comes to you and you suspect the presence of drug addict, you're supposed to inform Director of Medical Services as well as the Director of Central Narcotics Bureau. Sometimes also Section 60A of the Medical Registration Act may be invoked by the SMC investigator if they're writing to you, right, for your explanation on the SMC complaint. So those are where the law makes it very clear there's obligation to disclose. Later on, I will point your attention to a provision. Not many of you probably are aware of it. It's Section 424 of the Criminal Procedure Code, where there are certain little offences where you have a duty to report to the police. And these are penal code offences. Okay, in fact, the next slide, I will go through that with you. Right, so just bear that in mind for the time being. Now, the other category is where there are court orders. Obviously, if a court orders you to disclose information, you have to do that. Or when you feel that there's public interest that demands disclosure of such information. So the question here is, do you think there's any public interest, number one, to justify disclosure? And number two, is this one of those where you have a reporting obligation under the Criminal Procedure Code? Now the short answer, right, I know time's running out, is that there is no legal obligation to report on someone, okay, in terms of an offence which is of, say, the nature of a break-in or theft and stealing, okay? Because Section 424 of the Criminal Procedure Code usually involves offences where there is harm against person or aggravated offences. Okay, so in this scenario, there is no legal obligation, but of course, if you feel there is some public interest involved and you want to tell the police, make sure you can justify that. Now, the second scenario, right, will be where the police, right, tells you that an elderly shopkeeper was assaulted, sustained serious injury. So question mark, is this voluntary or grievous hurt with a dangerous weapon? We know that later that the witness reported that the raider was armed. Right. So that's one possibility. Or it can also be an armed robbery situation. Okay, so for this, there is actually a reporting obligation. Okay. In Section 424 of the CPC, for you to report. Now what happens if you don't? The onus is on you to report unless you have reasonable excuse not to report. So when you encounter situations like that, request for patient information, if in doubt whether there is any legal obligation, very simple, call MPS, right, contact one of us to advise you. Okay, now the last slide is on consent, very quickly. Right, this is probably sometimes situations that happen in A&E. No, age 16 brought in semi-conscious A&E, but police will request examination to confirm sexual assault. Just looking at this alone, just because the police ask you to examine, you just do it? No, I see some of you shaking your heads, right? So what should be done? Go age 16, immediately what comes to mind? Minor, right? So in a situation like that, what would be the proper thing to do? At least try to contact the parents, isn't it? Huh? So if the parents tell you, okay, go ahead, and I suppose you've got parental consent, or legal guardian or legal representative. Alright, so until you have that, just act. Unless it's a situation of necessity, life and death, then of course you have to act. As interest, you just have to do it, but justify, document your position. Of course, the variation to that is an older brother came along, looking drunk, and then saying, no, you cannot touch my sister. Do you listen to the older brother? See many of you shaking your head. As long as it's not parent, not legal guardian, not legal representative, there's no business consenting or not consenting on her behalf. Right? So this is just a very, I think, fundamental concept of consent. I think there's also issues of informed consent, which my good friend Emma mentioned just now. Perhaps we can reserve that for the discussion. I know time is coming. But just very final point. Always remember, as a doctor, claims, complaints, coroner's inquiries, medical legal advice situations always can come up in the course of your career, unless you are not a practicing doctor. Alright, so if you practice medicine, these are bound to come up. Okay? I think some of the speakers mentioned just now about clear communication, good communication. From our experience dealing with such cases, it's true, right? Usually it's because of communication breakdown that results in a breakdown of trust that results in medical cases. So as long as you practice with conscience, you practice compassionately, you feel your patient as though this person is your mother or your next of kin, right, you will find that very rarely would claims or complaints come after you. But even if it does, remember you are not alone. Contact MPS, there are people that else will help you. Thank you.